Let me invite our keynote speaker, Noful Ibrahim.
Good morning, everyone. I want to judge the quality of breakfast by the loudness of the good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
All right, let's start again. So, I'd like to start by thanking all the people on the organizers just to mention my name and voted and finally decided to invite me. I'd also like to thank all of you for attending because the conference is not a conference without participants. So, thank you everyone. Very honored that you did this talk. As you said, I've been involved with this for some time now. And it's quite humbling to, you know, there is no new level to something like this. So, thank you very much.
So, I'm going to be talking about mentoring.
The fiscal keynote is supposed to be something special. I try to make some special slides for it. So, what you can do is just. And so these slides, I'll talk about them later. Okay, I'll talk about how I made them and all that later, but I'm going to be using this slide actually. Alright, so let's start. So, my name is Noful Ibrahim, as you mentioned, very introduced me. I've been involved with the Python thing since 2009. Python India was part of the first one which held for Python and Dynamo in 2009, part of the organizing committee and all that. And since then, I've been involved in various capacities. Over the years, the amount of involvement I have at the Python routine business, because new people are coming, new volunteers, new patients, new energy. So the amount of time I had to put in reduced, and the amount of time I needed to put in also reduced. So it's not much anymore. I run a small company based in Java. We do automation infrastructure services. That's my main thing. But apart from that, I also run another company along with a friend of mine here. It's called People Academy, one of the smaller sponsors of the conference here, Video Training. And I spend time mentoring young college students. Right? So my work involves a lot of training and mentoring, and that all that experience is what I try to put into this talk. Let's get started. So I'm going to be talking about mentoring. Okay, I'm splitting this into three things. First, I'm going to talk about what it is, not what you need to teach or what you need to mentor, but what mentoring is. This is my definition of what mentoring is. Alright, second, I'm going to be talking about why we should do it, and what's the point in mentoring and all that. And finally, the bulk of the talk is going to be how, which is my experiences and how it's done, and how I do it, and maybe some great information. So let's start with the what. So what is a mentor? So, a mentor, the dictionary definition is experienced and trusted advisor. Right? And the important point is that a mentor here should be experienced. It's slightly different from a teacher. The mentor should be experienced in whatever he or she is mentoring. So, if you are a mentor, this term was originally used for craftsmen. So, if you are an experienced, say, blacksmith, and you get an apprentice blacksmith, you have to be experienced enough to be this person is still good at it. It's not just you read it from a book and you teach someone, that's not the way it works. That experience factor is important. The second thing is trust. I'm sure like all of us have teachers whom we don't trust. Right? I mean, you're from school or college, there's always teachers whom you're somehow trying to get away from because you don't trust them. That won't work if you want a mentoring relationship. There is some amount of trust resolved with the question of verification of knowledge which comes to you. That's something you need to do. But you have to draw the line somewhere. And the mentor is a person who can just take advice from mentoring without having to re-verify. That relationship, that kind of trust comes only after some time, but it's important for that relationship to be a mentoring relationship. It's not just teaching kind of setup. Also, a mentoring thing is usually long term. It lasts for a long time. It's not like you attend a workshop and sit, learn something and come out, or you take a MOOC or something and you learn something and come out. It's not like that. The relationship is usually long term. People stay in touch, like the mentor and the mentee stay in touch for a long time, stay in touch for a very long time. And the relationship just becomes stronger and stronger and stronger, and both parties benefit from it. It is something very different from the traditional teacher student relationship. And finally, the point, is there transfer of knowledge? Of course there is, and the mentor teaches students something. That's there, there is transfer of knowledge. But more importantly, there is transfer of accumulated wisdom. Wisdom is sort of knowledge tempered by experience with a lot of definitions. I'm using this for now. And I also like to think of it as compressed experience. If you've been in an industry for 10 years, you can't teach 10 years worth of knowledge to a person. But if you can sort of, align yourself in the right person, in the right way, the other person can sort of imbibe that experience from you. This is what we're thinking about. So it's not the transcript of knowledge, it's the transcript of accumulated wisdom, which is important. Alright. So there's a distinction that people make between teaching and mentoring. So I'd like to talk a little bit about that. This is my what I think about it. But at the top there's something like knowledge dispersal. You sort of like books and things like that. Somebody writes a book, or somebody puts a video of something that's done online or something like that. Anyone can see it, anyone can read it. It's sort of a one-way kind of thing. The knowledge is just dispersed. Anyone who wants can take it. That's very low engagement, but it's very high outreach. A lot of people can be used by it, but the engagement is very low. Slightly more closer engagement is if you're in a teacher-student kind of scenario. If you're in a classroom and you're sitting with a teacher and you're actually learning something from them, that's more engagement. But the outreach is limited, like only the people in that classroom benefit from that class. Finally, there's a mentor-mentee relationship. This is even more intense. It's very, very personal. It's between two people. And there, the outreach is very limited, but the depth and the subtleties of the transfers are very high. So I don't think it's possible to scale this out. Something which is very human and very personal. And so we have to appreciate it in that sense. That makes sense? Yeah. Now, this I think I'm hoping that this sort of covers what mentoring is. This is my understanding of what mentoring is. Now, we'll talk about the why we should do it. So, the first reason is moral responsibility. Yeah. So, when you reach the top floor, it's common courtesy to send a lift back down. Okay, somebody sent it down to you. Yeah. If you've been in the industry, you've got promotions, junior engineer, senior engineer, director, CEO, whatever. Like, it's a lot of people have helped you to get there. Right? And it's your responsibility to sort of do the same for people who are junior to you, who are younger than you, who are new to the industry. And here's a bit of homework you can try out. If you imagine that, I made it all by myself, I'm awesome, and my own hard work and intelligence and all got me there. Go home and just take a piece of paper and write out a list of all the people who have either taught you, encouraged you, inspired you, or told you something that is to your benefit. I will wager quite constantly that it will be a very, very long list. Yes? So you owe all these people something. And you might not be able to pay them back because they might be their senior people. But the way you pay it back to the community as a whole is to actually mentor junior people. Be that kind of person for a new guy who comes in. And if you think that you've come here completely by yourself, then you're wrong. There's no other way to put it. It's wrong. Alright? The next thing is to keep the profession alive. So here's the problem. See, like we all want to continue working in the areas that we do. We all want to continue to be programmers and stuff like that. Suppose tomorrow they decide that programming as a field is over, computer programming as a field is completely finished. Some of us might go into other professions, the other of us will be jobless. We have to sort of keep the profession strong and vibrant and innovative so that other people need it from us. If some guy wanted to do business, who comes and says, I need to make my thing work faster, can you help me with some software? That comes only if we can innovate and keep moving forward. And that kind of innovation moving forward is only possible if you can continue from where other people have stopped. You can't start from square zero every time. Right? So the way you do that is, as I mentioned, I talked about compressed experience. Right? The way we do that is, You compared your experience of the past 10 years, 15 years, whatever, how long you've been working, and you transferred that to the new guy who's come in as short a time as you can possibly. Then the thing is, they can continue from there. So the whole profession of the whole keeps going on and progressing. You can't do this in any other way. There's no way if somebody comes to me or starts from the very basic, it's not going to get anywhere. So that doesn't work. Then the other thing is a slightly selfish reason, which is, you know, mentoring someone is useful to the mentor as well as the mentee. You should be doing it purely selfishly for yourself. Have you tried teaching something to someone which you don't know? Like a topic which you don't know, which you're not really clear about. Have you tried teaching it to someone else? The first few questions that people throw at you, you know, make you go off balance. You have no idea what to say. And then you start bluffing and then I'll tell you later, let's take that offline, you know. You know, the usual thing. But so the thing is that if you really want to teach something, you have to know it really, really, really well. Because people ask questions which you haven't thought of. People ask, what if I do this? What if I do that? And, you know, I used like teaching Python, like I've been doing it for a long time now. And even now when I go to places, they say, what if I do this? What if I subclass this? What if I do that? What if I do this? And you're forced to think about things which have never occurred to you. Like I remember once I was doing some Python training and we wrote a class. The class was with all letters and stuff. By mistake, instead of writing class for the top definition, I wrote death. Then the question came, like, how is this changed? We have sort of written a class, a function with object as a parameter, and things like that, and what happened. Questions started coming up, and I was like, oh, no, so I haven't done this. So, those types of things come up only when you have to teach, right? And so the point I'd like to make is, if you know something very well, only then you can teach it. And there's also another thing. If you know something very well, then everything you say about it is worth learning. Like, every tweet that you put out about a topic which you know really, really well is worth learning. So this is like a walking fountain of wisdom. If you know something really well, and that comes only by practice, by teaching other people. You have to practice that. And it allows you to refine your assumptions, you know, refine your knowledge, revisit all the things that, you know, assumptions that you've made, etc. And it makes you better at your job. I don't know if you've heard of this thing called rubber duck debugging. People put a duck and they try to explain the program to the duck. Right? And then while you're explaining it, you understand what your mistake was. Now imagine if the duck was alive and can speak back to you. And then imagine if it's not just the program, but your entire mental model that you're explaining to the duck. That's basically teaching. So it's much more. It's like rubber duck debugging on steroids. And also, it's not just for a specific topic at hand, it's for your mental model and your process. It's a very meta question. It's much more than that. Okay. Then I think it also helps you hire it. Okay, so one of the things is like, you know how to say it, this horror story unfolding in the news. Episodes that keep coming out in the news about how, you know, colleges are bad, and Indian people are not trained, and this and that. And at the same time, there's so many ad things out there. Like, if I do this kind of thing, I just keep asking, give me a Python program or who does this, give me a Python program or who does that. And it's very hard to expect other people to train for exactly the way you want them. The better thing is to take a young person, unformed person, sort of, and mentor them in the way you want them to be. Like, over time, what happens is they become the ninja or the rockstar that you're looking for, rather than you searching outside. It's a much better way of doing it. Also, when you do it like that, there's a certain amount of comfort which that automatically comes. So they invite everything from you. It sort of suits the company better than this. It's a much better way to find new talent and keep them doing it. So with that, I've come to the end of why you should do it, and now moving to the what you should do. Before I start the how, I have a couple of things to mention. This stuff is very personal. Okay. The way you do mentoring depends on who you're mentoring and who is doing the mentoring. It works for X and Y, and only for X and Y. The same thing, if you change Y, it might not work. If you change X, it might not work. So it's very, very personal. So you can't apply all these things like directly. But I found that many of these things work in my among for various people I've done research. Of course, try to generalize the response to all. It's not one size fits all. It's not like buying ready-made. You have to buy ready-made because there's a real lesson. Because different people respond to different things. And you have to have some amount of human wisdom to understand what works. And this is basically why I put this short. If you take whatever you think, you reject whatever you think, and you take whatever you want to make sure that it works for you. I think it's also important for young people who are starting their career to learn tech skills. And along with learning tech skills, you can also learn mentoring skills. So as you grow as an engineer, you can also grow as a mentor. Otherwise, you become some caveman in a cave with a keyboard. That doesn't really help anybody. So, if I could talk about the first thing. So, the first thing I'd like to say is the programming method. So, this is something which I found very useful. So, software is not this thing about saying that you cannot teach a person can only learn by himself and himself. And the idea is this. If somebody asks a question about a certain topic, it's usually because there's a gap in understanding, a gap in the mental model. There's some dark spot in their understanding of things which they're asking you to help them with. And the way you tell them is not just to give them the answer is one way of doing it, but I've often found that it helps to make their mental models more concrete if you ask them questions. They ask them, it's not working like this. You know, why is it not working? What do you expect? Right? So things to answer. Okay, if you're doing this, then why do you expect what's going to happen? So because of this, is that what will happen? Oh, yeah, right. No, now I get it. That kind of thing is very satisfying for the person actually learning as well as for the person who is actually teaching. So, you pause the questioner with the right counter questions and sort of help them discover this content. That makes the mental model more concrete. Okay. It's different if you have just 1.5 hours to teach, then you have to give answers, then you ask a question, you give the answer and you're done. But if it's a long term mentoring relationship, you can afford to actually help them in the process of self discovery rather than just use an answer. It's much better than that. Sometimes though, people's mental models are not good enough to build these gaps, then you have to give them options, and it's a call you have to make. You should keep badgering somebody with questions, and you just keep breaking down. You should become, resist the talk about it, and sort of tell them what they need to do. Sometimes that's necessary, but generally it's a useful thing. Repetition is the mother of learning. So there's two things I'd like to mention here related to repetition. The first thing is the value of practice. This is something that's discounted a lot because we have an innate dislike for practice because it's often conflated with muscles, which is something we have bad memories of. But practice is actually very necessary. You have to keep practicing, otherwise you don't get the result. And people don't know this when they're trying to learn a new language or something. They learn. They do tech programs to give them an exercise. They do those tech programs and they can do that. You don't want it to be like that. You have to encourage people to practice more and more. Right? And if you don't do that, they don't get very far. Right? They show up after some time. So it's something that you should actively encourage people to keep practicing. Also, related to this is the value of repeated teaching. So here's the question, how many of you have used this function? You have not raised your hand. It's impossible to use function without using this. How many of you know exactly how this is implemented inside the C-Sharp interpreter? Like what all the data structures are and all that? Very few, right? Has that ever bothered you? Like, has it ever detracted from the value you have gained from using this? No, right? You've used it, but you don't know how it's implemented. But imagine the teacher insisted that you have to know exactly how to implement inside the interpreter before you even start saying n equal to open server. That hinders the teaching process properly. So it's perfectly fine to teach at a lower resolution server and then repeat, same calculation. The first time you teach just what you need to know to get some problems, and then you revisit it. And over time your understanding becomes deeper. Because I think the problem with introducing C as a first language is solved. You have to go every detail before you even write your first program to have to remember. You have to know memory, you have to know pointers, all of that. So, and that kind of thing kind of puts off people. So, it's fine to learn at a lower resolution at the first time, not like downloading a processor data. You get a variation first and just refine over time. Because of that. So, repetition is necessary not just for the series as a matter of practice, but for the physical questions again, more and more the time. Next step. The thing is, so this is also 3 points here. The first thing is the fear of failure. I know, I mean, given that we are in India, we are all conditioned to be extremely afraid of failure. Negative marks, minus marks for wrong answers in your multiple choice questions. Right? That's probably the most solicited question. You will not affect that if you are so afraid of getting it wrong. And you learn that as a life lesson. Like you come out and, like I've had people who write programs on, into a text file, into an editor, and they can be so rewritten up. They've not tried running it because they're so afraid of it. So they have to come and ask you to vet the answer. And you say, if I work with you, this person will need to do that way. And have you tried running it? No. They said, it's in the time. And there's no reason why. This is very much, I mean, it's hard for me to understand why this is happening. And this is the only reason why. Because people are so afraid of failure. And so when I do this kind of lesson process, I don't just encourage, I don't just say it's okay to fail. I actually encourage people to fail. They make, get this thing wrong. Yeah. And over time, what happens is people start thinking of it as this level, and they don't, there's no problem with failure. Once that happens, then they can actually make some progress. Yeah. So, you need some kind of system where you can fail deeply. If the cost of failure is that I drag the person in front of the class and make fun of them, like, you got it wrong, haha. That's not going to encourage anyone to make failure. So the cost is so low that people don't have a problem failing. And examinations are usually a tool for judgment. Why do you take an exam? To measure how good or bad you are. It's like a judgment. You fail, you pass, you're on the top 10%, you're on the bottom 10%. It shouldn't be a tool of judgment like that. It should be a tool of diagnosis. It should be like a medical exam. Like, if you have failed a medical exam, like you go to a doctor because you want a blood test, you can't fail a blood test. You find out what's wrong with you. That's the way it should be. Test should be like that. You've got a story. You take the test and now you know what's wrong with you. That's the way it should be. That's the first part of resilience, which is the personal thing, like an internal thing. The other thing is resilience to the outside world. And that is, you should teach the people you are mentoring to put up with crap. And I use the word crap in a technical sense. Crap stands for criticism, rejection, a-holes, and pressure. Okay. So there's four problems. So the problem that keeps plaguing you whenever you go out into the real world, and we like everything to be nice and people to be polite and friendly and encouraging, but it's not like that. Okay. And while we should try to make the community and people and the world generally like that, we can't deny the fact that it is not like that now. And so you have to develop some amount of resilience. It should be like, some dainty flowers that, withers away and blows away into the wind. That is very first sign of some kind of something negative within you. That won't work. You have to be able to face this kind of thing. And you stand up for people who can't stand up for themselves and things like that. So you need to nurture this in people. You can't expect people to be, very tender. It just doesn't work. I mean, as a practical point, it just doesn't work also. If you try to make people like that, if you try to make people nice to others, but the thing is that you shouldn't break down when you don't get that kind of niceness from others. That's my point. Alright. The next is hindering ambition. So this is sort of an address problem, at least because of things like Common Core and all that. But back in the day, when we were starting with the open source thing in India generally, there was this fascination for what they call low-hanging fruit. You take the simplest, tiniest problem that you can find, you fix that, and it becomes a little done. You shouldn't do that, right? You shouldn't just be satisfied that you sent one patch to one project. or contributed some grammar fixes to some weekly files. I'm not saying that none of those things are valuable, but that's, you should not stop there. And as a mentor, your job is to actually push people to aspire to do more. People have a lot of potential. Very often people have a huge amount of potential. It's hidden because of all the fear of failure and all the other things that I mentioned. But people have that kind of potential. And it's the job of a mentor to make sure that people realize this is the crutch that makes sure that the person stays crippled for their whole life. You should sort of encourage people to aim high. And convince them that you can continue with improvement and that it's going to be a never-ending journey. That's something, that's an attitude that you should give to the people who you're mentoring. You'll get better and better and better and better. The next thing, respect is good. So, my definition of respect is sort of understanding the mindset of the student who comes to you and talking to them in those terms. And there's a moral argument which is that you should respect people like that, and we're all familiar with that. But there's also more practical argument. Have you tried learning something from someone you absolutely hate? You can't bear to look at their face. Have you tried learning something from them? It's practically impossible. So there are these teachers who come to us, and we all have memories of teachers and students. They come to the class and like, oh God, somehow you check the class and then you get this thing over with a teacher's talking. If there is no respect, there can actually be no learning. If you want to create the kind of atmosphere where people can actually enjoy knowledge something, you have to engender an atmosphere of respect. Then only people will change what you have to teach. That comes by respecting them. And people have different needs, they have different obstacles, different potentials, different problems. All these things. And you have to sort of understand this and make a system in a tailor-made way. It's not a general method. So you should generally be agile and not a bully. Then rather than thinking of yourself as something that is wrong. The next thing. Remember how hard it was. And you try teaching someone and they keep stumbling over tiny problems. What the hell is wrong with you? For the 20th time, this is not the way you do it. And that's because you've forgotten how hard it was. The first time you try programming or doing something, you do really, really silly things, right? And one of the main things sort of things keep going on. I remember when I was first programming, I was programming languages basic. I didn't know about AND and OR and logical operators. And so I used to go nested if I wanted AND. If this, then if this, then if this, this would be AND and this other thing. But I thought that was really awesome, that's what I could do. So the point is that you made those kind of mistakes, and now if somebody else doing the same thing, you should derive some first. Better make that mistake. I had a recent experience with coding. I was teaching my kids how to write. You know, this technique, you draw straight lines, you draw flat lines, you draw floating lines, standing lines, sweeping lines, breaking lines, whatever. And when the kids write, they push down on the paper really hard. You really push the paper with a pencil. And you can almost read what you have written by just tapping it. And I tell my kids that one of the things I'm so hard, one time this one line, one of the books on a person. And they tell me, no, I can't write without this. And it's bad habit, etc. Then what I did was, I didn't try to teach myself to write with my dot on my hand. I'm a right handed person, I didn't try to write with my left hand. And I can't draw straight lines without touching the paper, no matter how hard I draw. But I have to keep it down like that. I have to put the paper down and you can almost tear it to how these things are going to happen. And I can't do that. I can't do it without that. Now when I tell my kids that they are teaching, I don't tell them that you should stress so hard because now I know what it's like. Okay, so we should sort of remember how hard it was for us when we try to tell others. Next thing, criticism. So this is sort of double edged sword. It's something that you need. All the other courses have, they become a bit funny because I said this like that. So the thing is, like, sometimes people need some process when you need to be constructive criticism. I don't like this kind of documentary words, but somebody said bossy value, or something like that. But you need to actually tell people, give people feedback of things they're doing wrong. And the aim is, think of it like a surgery. You're not doing the surgery to hurt somebody. You're doing the surgery to fix the problem, right? But it will hurt. What will be comfortable or something. To get it over with as quickly as possible and try to do it, you know, with anesthesia and stuff like that. You know, there are wrong ways to do it. You can get somebody in front of all the other students, all the other people who are the doctor or a proper education. You should do it in a way, you should want to figure out the right way to do it and gently make them understand what's wrong. So, this is something which I had a lot of learning to do because I tend to, unleash myself really, really quickly. I have to fix some myself, there is a problem, something important. Finally, a couple of things for the mentors to watch out for. The first thing is your ego. Right? So, I don't know if people have experienced this, I know that I have, but I think some personal experience. Sometimes, there's a bright person who will teach it. They learn and learn and learn and learn, and they finally achieve it. They become better than you in what you're teaching them. Right? So, the natural response of the human response, the natural quality of the human response, is to get jealous. You feel bad. Damn, I'm supposed to be a teacher, and obviously, I'm supposed to be a teacher. What do you think of this? And then the next thing is to become self destructive. The hypocrisy is trying to, marginalize this person, stop talking to them, show bad things to the camera or something like that. And people get really, it's very disruptive. And it's very silly. I mean, if the student does not achieve the teacher, the student has failed and the teacher has also failed. Right. The whole point is that the course is supposed to be started. As I said, you're starting them with your experience. You should progress from there. And think about this. You should blame yourself for be sad with yourself when someone is achieving. Why? Because when this person goes on to become like a really valued member of the community, they contribute a lot of stuff which is useful and they become very really useful to everybody. And they wouldn't have done any of that without you. Right? So you should actually be proud that they've actually gotten there. The only thing that doesn't like what has happened is your ego. It is not going to have any of it. It's not going to be anything. It's very important to do this. I think be careful. It comes unknowingly. It sort of it gradually comes. You should watch out for it. Not be there. And the other thing which is sort of correlated is this. Have you heard this thing? Those who can't see, those who can't do, those who cannot see. Yeah? This is something related to that. So, I mentioned earlier that you should know something really well to teach it and all that. So, there are people who don't know things really well and you just teach because they don't read something from a book and they teach it to someone else. The thing is that over time, what happens is if you see a large number of students, they all respect you, admire you, look up to you, and you start to enjoy the admiration. You start to enjoy the respect and the following sometimes you see to that. And you get addicted to that. That becomes your source of self-worth, which is not good. Because instead of these students will move on, they will get better than you, they will move on, etc. But you can't let that happen because this is your source of self-worth. So you start doing anything you want to make sure that you keep getting this. It's like a drug. Yes? And what happens is you make your students dependent on you. You don't tell them everything that they need to know. You don't, you sort of make sure that they don't go to, they don't focus too much to the extent that they don't need you anymore, and stuff like that. So, it is very dangerous because the students start to suffer, your attitude starts to suffer, all these things happen. So, it's not something which should happen, you need to walk out for it. Right? Finally, all the companies I've been talking about right now specifically target vendors. And one of the clients is target the vendors. It's a gold course, it's a loaded gold. So the reason is, there's a difference between a know-it-all who's got like 15 years of experience and knows for a lot of time and stuff like that. And a know-it-all who read some articles on hacker news and is coming out with so good news is what it is. The difference is that the person with 15 years of experience actually knows what he is talking about and the other person doesn't. And if you are like the kind of person who's so sure that you know exactly what you want already, like I know everything I need to know, there's nothing else that I need to learn from anybody else. Then what happens is this one problem. One thing is you stop learning, your water supply is cut off, like you stop dehydrating and you die. Second thing is when someone who's actually good comes there, you lose the opportunity to benefit from that person's knowledge. And all of us play a dual role. Like we are mentors to some things and we are mentors in other areas. And if you don't cultivate that kind of overwhelming kind of thing, you should be a student. You should always be a student. Like even if you are an experienced person. Because there's always something else to learn from someone else. And if you don't benefit to cultivate that kind of an atmosphere and that kind of an attitude and mental attitude, you will cripple yourself. Long term, short term, whatever you're going to get that. So you can do it. Don't limit yourself. It's just a takeaway. So, this is a point that I'd like to mention. And in the process of the organizers, I'd like to sort of send a dedicated conference to all the mentors among us, the people who we have mentored and we have mentors among us who have helped us to get where we are right now. I'm sure we can learn a lot of ways to turn that. And I'd also like to reaffirm our dedication to mentor the junior people among us to help them reach the greater heights in their lives. Thank you. So, I think 10 minutes of questions or so, then I have a small poll. Bit of a surprise at the end. You could end with a question. 5 minutes, 10 minutes. How much time? 10 minutes of question.
I would like to know from you, how the parents can become the mentor of their children. Because the children are so reluctant towards their parents. Sometimes, not always. So, how do you become the good mentor to that?
So, I'm a parent myself, and this thing is very tricky. I think the right way to do it is sort of, this thing about, do as I say, but not as I do. That's what most parents try to do. Like, they behave in a certain fashion. This is, for example, you're telling your kids, your kid is looking at a tab or something and they see that. And you look up from your phone and say, stop wasting time on the tab. That kind of thing doesn't help. I think, like for example, if you want to teach you want to encourage your children to be good readers, basically you're reading a lot. If you want to encourage your kids to, program or something, you should give them opportunities. Sometimes it just doesn't fit. It's impossible to make them exactly the way you want them. It's like Khalil Gibran said, like your children are arrows. You put them in a bow and you aim and they fire. You can do that much. After that, it's gone. So they find their own path and their own things. But your idea is to, and I'm speaking to someone about this, and my attitude is sort of, you should be a curator of the world to your kids. You should expose them to the best of humanity. Not the bad part. I mean, I'm not saying you should insulate them from the bad part, but you should expose them to the good part. You should expose them, you should restrict your kids, for example. I read a lot of complex books and stuff to my kids, literature. And I don't think they should be restricted to just reading, very, very basic kind of books. You should expose them to more and more. believe in their potential. When you expose them to their standards come up and they demand better and better and better things. And then you need to grow even more. It's not a threat. It's not creating the right atmosphere to get this happen, rather than six rules. And I don't think those six rules go out anyway. Because of where you stay and what your background is like, how many kids you have, all that. Yeah, over here. Oh, I'm sorry. The one point is, if you ever have, have you decided to give up on a menu? Like, because they can't be taught. Has this happened? Or has
it happened?
So, I was doing, so usually what my hope is that when someone is like really not responding to anything I say or do, my hope is that they just give up and go. Because then you can avoid all the unpleasantness. But that doesn't happen. So there was this gap I was mentoring, and simple program, like average of two numbers, write a function to find the average of two numbers. And often, like, a month or so, people in function. Who wouldn't be able to do it? And the thing is, you can give up also. He's trying. He's done everything. I set a class, like a new class, or so. He gets to do it. He keeps calling me. He keeps begging me. And I don't think I. That's all right. I get a feeling that my your impression to me was that you said not worth it. Don't waste your time. But he's putting in so much effort. I didn't have a task to tell him to just give up. And then get at this, and finally he had, he took a lot longer than average, but finally he got somewhere to do it, and he landed himself a job and he got to work. So, I think, one side, I would have originally said that, you should never give up and all of that, and interest would matter. But right now, I really think that's true because I have at least one example to prove that. Okay. Yeah, but you have to sort of custom, you have to sort of adapt the way you speak to them, you have to adapt to that, but you shouldn't give up on them if they are not. If they are, then they're not going to be able to do that. Okay, let's take this.
And actually, I want to ask, what is the most constructive way for us to feedback from the method?
Your current design is that if you can identify that kind of trust, then people, then all these barriers are not there. You don't see once the proper relationship is established, then this thing is easy to do because they can show you what they've done or. There are some basics of communication because they need to be clear in what they're asking, future challenges and stuff like that. But I think after that, once the trust relationship is established, then the question, the plan is established. Now you can just ask what you want and the other person understands what is being asked. I think that it's that relationship that needs to be established. Then this becomes a non-question.
So, we'll get to the next question in just a bit. I just want to let you all know that we are taking questions on the first floor as well. There's a mic going around. Just try to catch the attention of the person in the room.
I am a mentor as well. My question is, we personally are very used to getting answers. So, from school, we have. Some schools were taught that you ask questions, you get answers. So, when I try to teach people, for example, I am in team, I did not know it at that time, but I used to do what you mentioned as a Socratic method. So, what I do is when they ask a question, I ask them a counter question which addresses the thing that they do not know.
Yeah.
But the problem is, this becomes, very quickly start becoming frustrating for. The students or the mentee, because why are you not answering my question? Why are you counter questioning? So, how do you address this in a better manner?
Yeah, so this is a question of judgment. There's some kinds of, like I mentioned, relationship with person. Some things don't work for some students. There are some ways you just want answers. And we should sort of develop a feel for whether this person will respond to counter questions in a beneficial fashion, or whether they just get irritated. It's okay to slightly irritate, because you're a job. But, it's not not going far, they're not getting anywhere with that kind of thing, so we should sort of give them the answer right now. And then over time, if you start asking less questions, then it's fine. Some problem is happening. But if they keep asking the same questions again, then like there was a group, the teacher of wisdom is trained in the teacher of stress to earn, but less and less and less. They don't keep any mistakes asking you questions. But as long as the frequency reduces, you're doing it right.
So we have time for the last two questions, yours and yours.
Yeah.
The rest I believe Venkat is going to take it off by end.
Okay. My question is, I think that what we think doing and maintaining yoga or the same kind of exercise. So I don't think it's easy compared with maintenance.
I don't think so either, but I think mentoring has a decent problem.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That can be, but the effect are not always the same.
Right. So I think that, I use the word interchangeably in English, but I distinctively know that I think that teaching is sort of, slightly wider audience and slightly shorter term. Like I teach one course, or I teach one workshop.
And I just think teaching is very much formal profession, formal exercise, and this is all about it.
So, okay,
yeah, in case of mentoring, you don't have to cover any kind of material. Whatever it should ever, to achieve your target, you have to exercise that before. So, in case of teaching profession, you have to maintain a learning star bar path, you can say. To reach to some fixed point, which is already decided.
So, you put our both,
for both. Thank you.
My question is that over the years we have been great mentees from our 20-30 year company. So we have witnessed a lot of mentors who go the wrong way and sometimes we feel that they're spoiling the future generation. So how as mentees we can spend generation in such a way that how we can connect a mentor and a mentee matter.
Like there are some poisonous people there who just don't deserve to know, who don't shouldn't be doing it. And I don't know if like if the person is receptive to feedback, like are my professors who are genuinely receptive to feedback, then they have a common channel money to give them that. In this case, there are some people who are in this for the wrong reasons. And once you realize that, I think the right way of doing it is to warn the other mentees rather than focus on the mentor. Because this person is like this manager's person is genuinely, doing something wrong, then, and who knows that they're doing something wrong, then they're not going to respond to your feedback. You're a snitch, basically, like for that. So, I don't think you can really help. You have to protect other people from such people. If there's a feedback, then they probably make you aware of that as well. Like, oh, yeah, we got this wrong, we're going to see what you can do. Things like that are standard. Alright, what I'm going to say here is basically I have an old, this came up from the first one of the handbook, I got it on Twitter, I think. And it's basically an old, what they call notes of the mentor. Okay. So I'm going to read it out and keep content. And I'd like all of you to sort of join me in reading it out so you can take the notes and design formula to be like this. Alright, so let's start. The crowd is a registration desk gathered. And now my work is finished. It shall not end until the end of the sprint. I shall speak no jargon. Say no
subversion.
No well actually. And avoid all subtle meetings. I don't remember what it was like to be a beginner. I shall wear no crown and seek no glory in geeking out with all my conferences. And instead, will drop anything at a moment's notice to help any beginner with sympathy, patience, and a smile. I am the mentor in the darkness. I am the friendly fake coach in the hall. I am the dungeon of new happy program. I pledge my life and honor to the beginner's work. For this day, and all the scheduled concentration.